God's love is amazing, isn't it? Praise the Lord. If you will, you can go ahead and turn with me in your Bibles to Luke chapter 10. Oh yeah. So we can dismiss our children. I'm going to tell you how humble and appreciative we are that you've chosen to be with us at Pathway Church this morning, and we welcome you, and we do hope that you're blessed by the presence of God, and also by the Word of God. Amen? I do not believe that anything has changed me any more than when I got married and when we had a child. Those two events, those two things, pivotal moments, milestones in anybody's life completely change people, whether they admit it or realize it or not. And I can remember the kind of person I used to be and what used to be important to me, what I thought I had to have in order to have a fulfilled and fun life, so to speak. However, again, once I got married, and even moreover when I had a child, my understanding of love was revolutionized, completely turned upside down. And in a lot of ways, it was realized. I began to really kind of understand what love was. You know, a lot of times we have this idea that love is just a feeling. It's an emotion, right? It's something that, you know, the butterflies in the stomach and all that kind of stuff. But you really begin to see what love is when you have a responsibility towards another person. And as I began to be married and as Cross has started to grow up, there are a lot of things that were so important to me at one time that now they are not that important anymore. I'll give you some examples. Let's see that first slide. The first example that I have here is I used to love to watch History Channel and Fox News, right? Absolutely, that were the, you know, two things that stayed on my house, on my television all the time. In fact, I don't even know why I had any other cable television channels. However, since Cross has come along, I now watch Baby First and Disney Junior most of the time, right? Those two channels, which were so much a part of my life and so important to me, thinking, and I could rationalize, you know, I can rationalize why I needed to watch those things. I wanted to be an informed citizen, or I wanted to, you know, watch the History Channel. I wanted to learn as much as I can about history and maybe be able to apply it to my teaching or my preaching or anything like that. And so I could rationalize why they were so important and why I needed those things in my life. I can also remember about 2.5 years ago, I started exercising, and I became one of these people that had to exercise every day, because I felt like if I did not exercise every day, I would stop, right? And so 6 days a week, except for Sunday, I would exercise. I would beat myself to death. I would sweat, and it would be 30 minutes to an hour of just going as hard as I can, and I felt like I had to have that. I felt like that was absolutely necessary. Now what's most important to me is that we do the hot dog dance in my house. Anybody know what that is? From the Disney Mickey Mouse Playhouse, right? Come on inside, it's fun inside, right? And so that seems to be very important to me, because every time it comes on, Cross smiles just as big as he possibly can. On my day off, I used to go watch a movie at the theater. I'd stay at home and watch a movie. Now, what I do is I stay at home and watch my youngin'. And I wouldn't trade it for the world. It has become so important, so much a part of my life. It has become necessary. And I used to think that day was necessary, that I leave where I was, go somewhere else, and eat a big tub of popcorn while I watch a movie, right? I had to decompress. I had to get away from everybody. I just turn my phone off and do what I wanted to do. I used to stay up late and watch Netflix. Now, that was my me time at the end of the day, and I would stay up probably till 11:30 or 12 o'clock and fall asleep watching Star Trek or some other series on Netflix, right? And it was very vital that I do that. I wanted to maintain some sanity. Now I might fall asleep about 10 o'clock or so because I know I got to get up at 4 or 5:30 with that one. And it used to be that I had. Now y'all look at this book and you're like, there is absolutely no way I'm reading that. For me, on the other hand, I'm thinking I got to read this. All right, it's the Evangelical Dictionary of Theology, second edition. Anybody read it? Didn't think so. All right. Now, I'm a nerd, so in my mind, what I want to do is I just want to get to my office, get into this, get my highlighter and my pen and my sticky notes, and I just want to write all kinds of stuff. Now, it may not be stuff y'all ever tell anybody about, but I just love to read it. Or I get a book by Charles Swindoll or some other author and read that. And that was necessary. It was one of those things I just had to do. You know, and you would think, well, yeah, you're a preacher. You've got to study. You've got to do those things. But I'm telling you, I did this for fun. All right? Now what I read is Danny and the Dinosaur. All right? And it starts out, one day Danny went to the museum. He wanted to see what was inside. So that's what I read. I'm reading now. Now, say all that to say this, is that our love for other people causes us to change, doesn't it? It causes our priorities to change. It causes those things that once seemed to be so important, so vital, and in a lot of cases so necessary to us, all of a sudden they're not as important as we once thought they were. There are practical changes in our priorities because we love somebody. There are practical changes in our lifestyle because of our love for somebody, whether it's a wife or a new child. There are things that you let go of without a second thought. It doesn't bother me that I don't get to go to the movie theater as much anymore. I don't care about it anymore. Right? It doesn't bother me that I don't get to watch the History Channel as much as I wanted to. It doesn't bother me that, and some of you are like, it wouldn't bother me either, that I don't get to read as much of this as I used to do. Right? It doesn't bother me. Because it seemed so important at one time, but because of my love for that one, it's not that important anymore. It's not that necessary anymore. Yet. You remember, all of you probably remember adjustments that you made when you got married. And those adjustments were probably hard the first year or so, right? What you spent your money on changed. What you spent your time doing changed, didn't it? Because now you love someone that you didn't love before. You were committed to someone and you had a responsibility towards that person that you didn't have before. The major point that I want to get across this morning is this. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind means that you hold all other things loosely. So if I'm going to love God with everything that's in me, it literally means that everything else that used to be important to me, everything else that used to be necessary to me, I am willing to let go of. That's what it means to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And this is exactly what Luke gets to in Luke chapter 10, verse 25. A certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said, "What is written in the law, and what is your reading of it?" So he answered and said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind." Let's pray. I'm going to ask Brooks if you will pray for the message.
Father God, I just thank you, Lord, for your word this morning, God. I thank you, God, for the worship, Lord.
Yes,
Lord. Thank you.
Amen. What you have here in this scripture is you have some lawyers, so to speak, Pharisees, I guess we could say. These guys that come to Jesus and they're really trying to trip Jesus up. And one of the things he asks is, what have I got to do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus says, well, what do you think it is? And the guy answers, and he answers rightly. And he says, well, you're supposed to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And Jesus says, that's well, that's good. You answered that pretty good. And the thing Jesus kind of boils down to, though, is he wants the guy to understand what that really means. It's one thing to say that I love my wife or that I love cross. It's quite another thing for me to actually show and express that love in the way I'm committed to them, right? And the word that he uses for love, and Pastor Tom touched on this last Sunday, is a Greek word called agape, or agapeo. And basically what it means is it means unwilling to abandon, totally given over to someone or something. And that is the kind of love that is required of us as we seek to love the Lord. And I just want to show you this morning, what I want to do this morning is kind of go through and tell you kind of what that looks like on a practical level. See, Jesus told the Pharisees in the next chapter what they really love. See, it's one thing, like I said, to say you love God, but Jesus actually goes deeper into their understanding and into their mind, and he begins to show them what they really love in chapter 11. Yeah, they said they love God, but Jesus says in chapter 11 when he speaks to them, he basically says what you really love is the best seats in the synagogues, and you love the applause of people. And he uses the same term there, agape. In other words, what you're really fully committed to, what you're really, listen to this, unwilling to abandon is the best seats in the synagogue. What you're really unwilling to abandon is the applause of people. That is what you love. Now, I think if every one of us were to look deep into our hearts and look into our lives, what we would see is we would see there are some other things that we love besides God. Just like these Pharisees. These Pharisees would say with the utmost credentials. In fact, if you were to ask the common man who are the most righteous and holy people of their time, they would point to the Pharisees and say, those are the most godly people. And they would say that we love God, and Jesus peels back the facade, peels back the mask, and says, no, you don't love God. What you really love is you love people's approval. What you really love is you love the prestige that comes with having the best seats in the synagogue and having the most important people invite you over for dinner. That's what you're really committed to. Now, that's not an easy word to digest, especially if you're a Pharisee. But let me just knock us all down a notch for a moment. I would think in some ways we're all Pharisees. We all have something that we are completely committed to other than Jesus Christ. So this morning, one of the things I want you to understand is that this is vitally important we get this. Because if you do not realize it, all the other things in this life besides your relationship with God are temporary. Even the people that are most important to you and the people you would think will never abandon you, there is that possibility that it could happen, right? Those closest to you could die. Your health, which seems so vital and so strong, you could lose in a minute. I believe it, I know. Right? The friends that you once relied on and depended on can become unreliable. You've seen that happen. As we look at our life, we realize, and I don't know if it's just, you know, we just think that we are the exception to the rule or what the case is, but a lot of times we realize everything else is temporary. Everything else in this life will let you down. Right? All things in life are temporary. Y'all remember in middle school how permanent a boyfriend was or a girlfriend was, right? Depending on the depending on what day of the week. Unfortunately, that's carried over into adulthood because half of our marriages end in divorce. Those close to us do die and pass on, but there is only one thing that is necessary. And Jesus points this out when Martha and Mary are at his house, or he's at their house, and Martha is doing as much as she possibly can to keep everybody pleased and to impress everyone and doing things that seem very necessary and very important. Mary is at the feet of Jesus, and Martha says, Jesus, can you tell her to get up and talk? And Jesus rebukes Mary and says, look, only one thing is needed. Only one thing is necessary. And that one thing Mary has chosen and will never be taken from her. Isn't that good to know that there is something that we can rely on, something that we can depend on, that will never be taken from us? And he is saying to us, trust me, fully commit yourself to me. Be unwilling to abandon me. And I'm telling you that not because God is not saying that he's doing that because he's egotistical or because he somehow needs your love. He is saying that because he knows that he is the only dependable thing that can exist in this life. He's saying, I'm the only thing that will not let you down. I'm the only thing that has your best interest at heart. Even when you don't have your best interest at heart, I do. And I'm telling you, depend on me and I won't let you down. That is why he asks us to love him. Not because he is so full of himself. Not because he is a dictator demanding our love. He is saying, this is the best possible life, is you depend on me. Because everything else is shifting sand. It's unfortunate, though, that the roots of our hearts, A.W. Tozer wrote this, the roots of our hearts have grown down into things. And we dare not pull up on a rootlet lest we die. Things become necessary to us. Think about it. Think about all the things, we live in a very consumeristic culture, don't we? Starbucks is necessary, isn't it? Necessary. This is not what I want. This is what I need. Right? Television is necessary. There's all these kind of things in our lives that we find that are necessary. And Tozer writes this. He realizes this some 50 years ago when he's writing this. He says, things have become necessary to us. God's gifts now take the place of God. And let me say this. Every time we do that, we will find ourselves disappointed. Amen? You will. Now, you can tell what you love by what you sacrifice. Let me tell you a story from the Old Testament, Genesis 22. There's a story in the Old Testament of the patriarch Abraham. And I'm sure Pastor Tom has told this story numerous times, but Abraham was promised a son, and it was years before that promise actually came into fruition. This was something he had imagined for years, something he had hoped for, something he would look forward to, is this son that God had promised. And he had tried a couple of times to do it his way, and some things happened. But ultimately, Isaac, which means laughter, was born. And as Abraham and Sarah celebrated this birth, and Isaac grew up before him to become exactly what God had promised, and when Abraham looked at him, he saw the promises of God. He saw that nation that would come forth from his womb, and he saw that eventually that all the people that would come forth from this child would number as the sands on the seashore and the star in the sky, as God had promised. And then one night, God speaks to Abraham. Now we have this image in our head of a little child, but Isaac was probably about, late 20s. And he speaks to Abraham and he says, Abraham, I want you to take your son, the one that you love, an offering as a burnt offering. One author describes this image, and he says, can you imagine this bent soul wrestling and convulsing with God over this decision? Now, I want you to think about these, something that seems most important to you, and God would say, I need that. Abraham gets up the next day, and he and his son go 3 days' journey into the wilderness. They find a mountain called Mount Moriah. They go up on top of that mountain, and you all know the story. And I can't imagine this climb. Can you just imagine? And then Isaac asks, hey, you know, Dad, we've got fire. We've got wood. Are we missing something? Yeah, God will provide. Right? They make it up. Abraham ties Isaac up. At this point, you know, this is something that Isaac is willingly doing. Raises the knife to slay his son. And God stops him and says, I just wanted to know. Not that God didn't know. But I just wanted you to see how committed you are. Right? That is love. You can tell what you love by what you are willing to sacrifice. Think about it. Now, if you love food, you will sacrifice your health for that food. Won't you? We will. Oh, well, I don't care if I have a heart attack. I don't care. And I'm not trying to tell you can eat whatever you want to. I'm not trying to be legalistic here, okay? God has already done away with those regulations. But we sacrifice for things that we care about, don't we? If you have a career or you seek to make money, a lot of times, unfortunately, people will sacrifice their family in order to gain a position or to make more money. Sometimes people will sacrifice their morals or their principles in order to gain the approval or the acceptance of other people, unfortunately. A lot of times, and I think this is probably most common among Christians, is that what we do is we will sacrifice our relationship with God for comfort. It's very uncomfortable to draw near to God and have an engaging relationship with God. Because a lot of times it requires us to change. It requires us to give something up. It requires us to examine ourselves. And so therefore, so we can remain comfortable, we stay at a distance with God. We will sacrifice many things to get what we love. And so when you look at your life, I want you to think about what are you sacrificing for what you love. And when you look at what you're sacrificing, you'll see about what you love. What God calls us to do is He calls us to love Him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that means, like I said before, that we hold all other things loosely. Everything else. I hold my study loosely. I hold my other relationships in my life loosely. It doesn't mean I don't care about those things. It doesn't mean that I have to totally give those things up. It just means I have to have in my mind an understanding that those things are in no way as important as my relationship is with God. Amen? So therefore, I hold them loosely. I realize from a young age that you can lose people. So you hold them loosely. You love them. You sacrifice for them. You seek their well-being. But at the same time, my whole life cannot be completely and utterly dependent upon a person who is fallible and who is fragile. And so I hold them loosely. Because a lot of times, if we're not careful, what we hold on to, what we grip so tightly, actually has a grip on us. Right? And and we don't realize it. And so there are four areas in our life I think we should examine to see whether or not we're holding on too tightly to those things or those people, or whether we are actually doing or loving the Lord. The first thing, the first area I want you to examine in your life is this: our possessions. Our possessions. Things. What is something in your life? What is it that is so important to you that you're willing to sacrifice for that? You're willing to sacrifice maybe time with your family. You're willing to sacrifice money. Or you're willing to sacrifice something else in order to gain that thing. Now in America, this is a problem more than it is in any other place in the world. But there are so many things in this life that we can be attached to. So many things that we can be completely given over to. So many things that we are unwilling to abandon. So let me ask you, what is a thing in your life that you could be unwilling to abandon? What possession do you have that you say, I would be unwilling to abandon that? Second, position or prestige. This is where Jesus got on the Pharisees. What is that position? Maybe it's a job. A position in the community. Maybe it is the approval of people. And so you do everything you can to please people. And Jesus is very clear on this. I can't please people and God. Now you know that, right? And so we want to do everything we can to gain people's approval. We want to do everything we can so that people will like us. Examine yourself. Is that a problem for me? Is that something that I am unwilling to abandon? Is people's approval or a position or the prestige that comes with that? The other thing is our dreams. Maybe it's that job that doesn't materialize. For Brooks and I, it's very personal sometimes. You know, when you get married, obviously the next thing you expect at some point is to have a child, right? We were basically told you're not going to have a child. And so I had to learn early to hold that loosely, right? Okay, God, if that's what you want, I'm fine with that. Now, obviously, He saw fit to bless us with a child later on. I'm 37 years old. Most people have a child when they're in their mid-20s, I guess. And so you hold that loosely. What dream is it? Maybe it's just this dream to become a better person. Maybe it's a dream to have a certain job. I don't know what dream it is you seek to fulfill. But sometimes we allow those dreams to control us more than we do God. And so you've got to learn to hold those things loosely. The other point here is our relationships. This is very, very important. I think this is as dangerous, probably not more dangerous than things. That there are certain relationships in our life that we hold so tightly to. And here, God dealt with Abraham on this very topic. Take your son, the one that you love, and let him go. Take your wife, your husband, the one that you love, let him go. Doesn't mean you don't love him. It doesn't mean you don't care for him. Doesn't mean you're not committed to him. It just means that I understand that they are a person. See, here's the thing that we do if we're not careful with people, is we will put people, especially when you first get married, this is what happens. You put people up on a pedestal. You make them God. You have certain expectations for them to fulfill. In other words, you know, once I got married, here's Brooks, and I have her up on a pedestal, and I say, well, Brooks is going to do this for me. She's going to be this kind of individual, and she's going to be cheery and happy all the time. And I have married her because she makes me happy. How horrible and selfish is that of me to lay that kind of weight on her. In essence, what I'm doing is I'm telling her that she is God, and I have held on so tightly to her, not realizing that she is a human being that will sometimes fail and that will sometimes fall short. But we do this to people every day, don't we? It may not be a husband. It may not be a wife. It may be a co-worker. It may be a friend that you have in your family. Or it may be someone here at church, and you put certain expectations on them, and you expect them to make you happy or fulfill something for you. And then when they don't, you get all upset and so angry at them, or maybe even at God, because they weren't the person you thought they would be. How selfish is that of us to lay that kind of weight on another individual? Saying to them, in essence, you be my God, you make me happy, you bring fulfillment to me. I'm going to love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then our world comes crashing down when she comes home and has a bad day, right? Oh, you're supposed to make me happy. You're not supposed to have a bad day. Or our co-worker didn't do something we expected him to do, right? Or somebody in church that we thought was a good person, they have some sort of moral failing, or they trip up in some way or say something that was offensive, and now all of a sudden our whole faith is shaken because that preacher or that Sunday school teacher, that individual that I esteemed so highly, and I just thought, man, they're everything. They let me down. That's why God is telling us, if you love me with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, everything else, you hold this. Amen? We will please stand. This morning, what I want us to do is I want us to examine our hearts. And I want us to have an Abraham kind of moment. I want you to look at yourself and see, is there some possession that has a hold of me that I am gripping so tightly? Is there a position, is there some sort of prestige that I'm seeking that grips me so tightly? I work so hard because I want people to admire me. That can become something that you love. I've got to have that car. I've got to have that television. I've got to have that home. I've got to have that yard. It can become something you love. I've got to fulfill this dream, this ambition. If you're not careful, it can become something that you are totally given over to, unwilling to abandon, even to the point of risking the relationship with God, which is the only necessary thing. Maybe it's another person. I don't know what it is that you may be gripping so tightly. It could be your health. The last time I was sick, you know, you start to think about your mortality. And I just know that I'm not going to live as long as somebody else my age. I know, or somebody else that, you know, is my age and doesn't have the same conditions I do. But I came to the point when I was sick where I was okay to die. Finally, had to hold my health, my life loosely, and allow God to take me. And I said that in church one Sunday, and one of the ladies came up to me crying, and she said, "Don't ever say that again. You don't have to be sick to know that you're going to die." When Brooks and I first began to date, and right before I asked her to marry me, I knew I was going to marry her. She said she knew she was going to marry me. But I realized how tempting it can be to say, "Oh, that's what life is all about. in the movies, and our culture does that, doesn't it? I told Brooks, I said, look, I just need 3 days to pray, and I'm going to, you know, and I know some of you like to keep it. I don't want to talk to you, I don't want to see you, nothing like that. And I couldn't explain it to her at that point. During that 3 days, I wrestled very hard with everything about what was going to transpire, and I had to do what Abraham did with Isaac. I had to let him go. I had to hold her. Say, she is not my everything. I still wrestle with that temptation. And I had to put God in his rightful place. And I don't know what it is for you. This morning, as I pray, I want you to join me at this altar. And I want you to take an Abraham walk and bring whatever seems most precious to you. Lay it down at this altar as a sacrifice and say, God, I'm holding all things loosely that I may love you with my heart, soul, mind, and strength. If you will come. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus this morning. The command to love you with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind is not an easy one. It is one that is gut-wrenching. It is one that causes us to examine ourselves and our motives. And this morning, as we walk to this altar, I pray that you help us to bring everything that is dear to us. Not that we don't love those people, not that we don't enjoy those things that you have given us, but we lay it on this altar and we hold it loosely and we praise God for them. And we say by holding them loosely that those things, those people, those dreams, those positions, they're not our God. You are. Oh, the Pharisees thought that they had a love for God nailed. They followed all the rules. They were able to recite long passages of the Old Testament. They didn't work on the Sabbath. They stayed holy and clean. But they were not unwilling to abandon the best seats. They were not unwilling to abandon their prestige. They were not unwilling to abandon the applause of people. And we are no different this morning. And we're unwilling to abandon. Unwilling to abandon that possession that grips us. Unwilling to abandon that thing that grips and holds our heart in a vice. God, this morning we lay those things that seem most precious to us on the altar. If it's a person, we lay it on the altar and we let that person, we lay them on the altar, we let them go, not because we don't care about them, but because we do care about them. And we know that in your arms is the safest place for them to be. That dream that we have, we lay it on the altar and we say, God, we know that you know best, and we know that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and whatever my path may be that you have directed, that is the one I will walk. God, this morning, we want to love you. But we need your Holy Spirit to place that kind of love inside of us. For in and of ourselves, our love is selfish. Our love is blind and short-sighted. It is nothing more than an emotion, something fickle and fragile. But as the Holy Spirit enters our hearts, He reveals to us what real love is, what commitment is, what responsibility is. and He changes us. So that what was once important and needful, what was once so necessary for us, it's not that necessary anymore. This morning we lay that person, that child, that husband, that wife on this altar. We lay that job that has consumed us, that career that has consumed us. We lay it on the altar. Oh, it has its place. They have their place in our life, but nothing can take your place. Lord, this morning we lay the approval of people, that prestige that we so desire, we lay it on the altar this morning. Lord, we lay that thing that controls us. Comfort. Television. A home. A car. A vehicle. Nice clothes. Whatever it is that we sacrifice in order to obtain, we lay it up here and we say, God, I know I need some of those things. They're not all that important. You're the necessary things. You're the necessary things. Father, if we're going to love You, let us hold all other things. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to hug someone's neck this morning. You can pray for them. Tell them you're glad to see them in church, and maybe somebody has a need that you want to pray for. Just share that with your neighbor or whatever, and you can pray. Other than that, you can just mingle and be this one.